Before we start, I'd like to talk about a couple of things, just some in-house rules, okay? First thing, no food at all. No candy, no wrappers, no gum, none of it, okay? Because I'm not trying to clean it up after this. It came in, it looked really nice, right? Like it's clean. When you leave, it should look the same. Understood? Awesome. Second thing, please, while we have our speakers, remain seated. I understand some of you may need to use the bathroom or et cetera. It's only going to be a short time, okay? So try your best to remain seated. If you do have to leave, those are the doors that you may exit. Please do not exit any of the side doors, okay? In addition, cell phones away. We will have this live stream. So, which means you can see it after this on YouTube. Okay, seriously? Thank you. So I would like to introduce our speaker today. His name is Michael Ford, known as a hip-hop architect, as he leads a national initiative exploring architecture and urban planning through the lens of hip-hop culture. Ford is the founder of the Hip-Hop Architecture Camp, an international award-winning youth camp which uses hip-hop culture as a catalyst to increase the number of underrepresented communities in architecture. Ford is currently working with the hip-hop community, including pioneer artists such as Curtis Blow, Ice-T, LL Cool J, that's my time by the way, as it leads the programming and development of the Universal Hip-Hop Museum in the Bronx. Michael Ford's work has been featured on Today's Show, ESPN, and The Vibe magazine, y'all. You know how hard it was for me to get this man, by the way? Yeah. So please, a little bit louder, let's welcome Michael Ford.
She did a great intro, and I've given this talk at a lot of different places, so I'm happy to do it here. I travel around giving talks about how architecture and urban design has impacted communities of color, and then how can communities of color use their cultural genius, which is hip-hop, and create our own style of architecture. And I will say that I got this parental advisory sign up here. It might be a couple words. We're talking about hip hop, right? So sometimes you might hear something and see something that's like, that was kind of tough. But Dean Wright don't know what it is, so she's not responsible for it. So if somebody get mad, they can, I guess, be mad at me for putting it in here. But y'all are smart kids, you know, to respect the words as used in an academic setting, so you don't have to repeat any of the words that you hear here today. So, I've given a talk at places like my alma mater. I'm from Detroit, so born and raised in the D. Oh, it's my from Detroit, I'm stacking up for the D. So I'm from Detroit, I've been living here in Madison just for about 7 years. Went to college at University of Detroit, where I got my master's degree, and I also taught there for a while. Moved here to Madison to work at a firm, and I taught here at Madison College. Now I'm on my own, working on my own projects, and also conducting the camp and working with a ton of hip-hop artists that you will see later on today. I heard some young ladies in the front, I didn't know my screen was on, they seen Super Peach. Who was that? So I was like, is that Super Peach? It was one of y'all in the front. Yeah. So I'll get to that towards the end, some of the artists I'm working with, and some of the stuff that I'm with I like to start off with this song, and I'll play a number of songs throughout, but I just want you guys to listen and read the words. We can start with his coat, and then we called it a remix to that swan chair. when we put a little hip-hop on top of it. And this Timberland hoops before hip-hop, right? So this was hoops that people would wear down the construction site, down with the toes to get messed up. And then this Timberland hoops after hip-hop. Well, the image don't even change, right? So the hoop didn't really change, but the whole meaning behind it. You ain't gonna wear no Tims on a construction site with concrete all over and walk through mud. As soon as you get mud and concrete and all that on the Tims, you know, they're garbage now. And then it's NBA shorts before hip-hop. The state is just like waiting to happen, right? All right, and then this is shorts after hip-hop. So again, I'm from Michigan, but at the University of Michigan, whoever watched ESPN 30 for 30? Y'all watching those? So they had one about the University of Michigan. So Chris Webber, Jalen Rose, they talked about the headphones that they wore before going out and play. The reporter asked them, what do y'all listen to before y'all go to court? It's like hip-hop. And they were known as the people who started to wear longer shorts for the first time in basketball. Now, these shorts might be considered kind of small today. Then this basketball is way bigger. All right, so this couple who made it. I was in Toronto a few weeks ago, so I had to add an image up in there. So this is basketball after hip-hop, with Drake being the ambassador for the Toronto Raptors. All right, this is a record player before hip-hop. So what came after this? Exactly. We took our grandparents, our parents' record player, and turned it into, you know, a multi-billion dollar industry, turntables. We had headphones before hip-hop. What's after this? Hey, y'all got it. All right, so beats. So Dr. Dre said, I'm going to make headphones have the ability to have everyday people listen to music the way that we intended for it to be heard. This is the President of the United States before hip-hop. Right. And then after hip-hop we had, nah, y'all wrong, we had our first black president, Bill. Nah, it's Barack. So President Obama used hip-hop not once, but two times to help mobilize first-time voters to help him win the White House. Let's give it up for President Obama. And I should say former President Obama, right? So hip hop was very involved with politics in the town. Like Diddy had Rock the Vote, Jay-Z, a lot of people was out. And then hip hop kind of got disinterested in hip hop. Let's give it up for our president right now.
You're not black.
Interesting. And then this is architecture before hip-hop. So this is Frank Lloyd Wright, Wisconsin native, one of his most famous or iconic pieces of architecture. This is like for many people, I won't say for me, but this is like the iconic piece of architecture, right? This represents architecture. So this is architecture before hip-hop. And then this is architecture after hip-hop. So that's what I'm going to share with you today, and hopefully you guys, even people that might not be interested in architecture, could see how you could put your culture on top of it, and even if you don't become an architect, how can you use architecture or influence the spaces that's in your community? All right, so does anybody know who any one of these people are? I didn't expect you all to. So the short guy in front is Pablo Picasso. Oh, and then the guy in the back, his name is Le Corbusier, he's a Swiss architect from back in the day. But these two people had a pretty significant impact on art in the world. So Picasso and Corbusier is considered one of the best architects of all time. He did a lot of stuff for architecture. But this is something that we don't learn about. So again, I got my master's degree in architecture and never heard this conversation. They called themselves Negrophiliacs. All right, so of course that's not them for real. That's like a picture from Run-DMC with their faces on it. But they called themselves the Negrophiliacs. And basically, they called themselves this. This is back in the 1920s. Because black culture influenced a lot of their work. And the word Negrophilia basically means the love of the Negro. Right? This was, again, this is from a whole other decade, I'll talk about that now. But black art influenced their art. and these stories are not told. And it's the same thing that's happening with hip-hop today. So I'm gonna give you this little old school example, and I'll bring it up to what's going on today. So again, Pablo Picasso was influenced by African art. It was some tribal masks from the Boom tribe that Picasso used to make probably his most famous painting. So on the right, or on my left, I should say, is a Pablo Picasso painting called Les Demoiselles de Avignon, which means the Young Ladies of Avignon. It's pretty much, in my opinion, his most famous painting. And on the other side is Pablo Picasso's sketches of African tribal masks that he collected and studied. And if you look at the face from the African tribal mask that he was sketching, and then look at the two faces in his painting, you can easily see where he was influenced. All right? And he denied it for a while, even joked and said, African art, what's that? All right? As if to say he didn't even know about it. But eventually he would talk more about it, the history would be learned, but it's still not widespread. I didn't learn about this in high school, I had art classes. Didn't learn about it in college. Didn't learn about it until, you know, I did some research on my own, and we had a few papers about it. So Pablo Picasso, this painting started a movement called Cubism, which like shook up the whole world. And Picasso, when he drew those faces that looked like a tribal mask, he would never draw the same again. He always drew like that for the rest of his career. So those images you see that look like scribbles rival, or you know, these faces with weird perspectives, is actually inspired by African tribal art. So last image from Picasso, the blue image, he always drew himself after a certain period. So he said that this was his blue period, and he drew himself, he has his blue background, and his face looks normal, right? That's before he was introduced to African tribal art. So he had a period of art that's also not talked about a lot. It's called the black period. And sometimes it's conveniently left out of school curriculum. All right, so during the black period is the other painting. You see that he painted himself like we would describe African Americans in a very racist way. All right, the larger nose, the more defined facial features. So he saw himself differently after he got introduced to African tribal masks. So black culture has been influencing art and the world for a long time, just always been kept under the rug. So even this conversation about mixing architecture and black music, something that I do, and I go around people like, oh my, you're a genius, how did you do this? It's other people who talk about it. And it was somebody who wanted to do it a long time ago, but he wanted to take black music and make architecture out of it. It was that dude, Le Corbusier. I'm not gonna get too much into this history, but he met this lady who circled. Her name is Josephine Baker. Who heard of the Harlem Renaissance? You people heard of the Harlem Renaissance. But the Harlem Renaissance was kind of like hip-hop is today, but it was for jazz. We have all these jazz artists, a lot of them in New York, all around the world. But he met this lady, Josephine Baker, while on a cruise, and was like, hey, I want to learn more about, essentially this is what he was saying, or thinking. He wanted to learn more about jazz music so he could turn it into architecture. And Josephine Baker is probably one of the most famous jazz artists from the Harlem Renaissance. And there's a song which describes exactly how he, this dude like straight up stalked her. He met her on the boat, he popped up at her house or her apartment in New York before. He wrote love letters to her. Well, he wrote love letters to his mama about her and he was married. Very weird dude. But it's a song that describes exactly how they met. So I like to play this song and I'll show the words. And I'm sure y'all heard the song before, and we'll have some fun in my scenes at the end.
Have you ever met a girl that you tried to date, but a year to make love, she wanted you to wait?
Every word you hear by Biz Markie, if you read the words, is exactly how they met. The way that I met her was on top of her pizza. She had long hair and a short mini skirt. I just got on stage, dripping warm with sweat. I was walking through the crowd. Guess who I met? I whispered in her ear, come to the picture room so I can ask you some questions to see if you're on your proof. I asked her name, she said, blah, blah, blah. She had 9-10 pants and a very big bra. I took a couple of looks since she was enthused. I said, how do you like the show? She said, I was very amused. I started
No, I don't. I only have a friend.
All right, y'all know the song, bro.
Come on. I'm not even going for it. This is what I'm going to say. You got what I need. Have you ever met a...
All right. So y'all know the song. Cool. So he was basically saying, like, Josephine Baker has something that he needed. He was his architect, and he needed someone to make his architecture better than everybody else. And he thought that he was going to hook up with Josephine Baker and learn about jazz and make some projects for her and become this world-famous architect that incorporated black music. But if you look in the corner over there in that picture, you can see her trying to, like, get away from him because he was, like, all in his, yeah. Very real dude. But he would go on to say something, and I love to share this quote when I go to different colleges and universities who love to talk about Le Corbusier as like this famous or this great thinker. Basically, well, I'll read the whole thing. Negro music has such America because it is the melody of the soul joined with the rhythm of the machine. It is in two-part time, tears in the heart, movement of the legs, torso, arms, and head. The music of the era of construction, innovative. It floods the body and heart, it floods the USA, and it floods the world. Then he will go on to say that jazz music is more advanced than architecture. And if architecture was at the point reached by jazz, it would be an incredible spectacle. So he was saying this back in the 1920s, like, man, black people can, they don't even know how to read music. They can pick up my trumpet, they can pick up the drums, the trombone, the saxophone, and they can play it better than I can, and I'm traditionally trained in music. We can have seniors here who have nothing written down. They can come together, sing a song, and never met each other a day in their life, but they can come together and make something beautiful and make something better than us who have been studying music and writing music for years. He wondered if architects can come and learn the same thing from jazz artists. Can we get architects to come together and make something that's just as beautiful as jazz music? Because architecture needs a plan. We gotta know each other, a whole lot of talking and coordination. It's like, hey, we're not using the tools right. We need to use our architectural tools like the jazz musicians, right? So that was back in the day. And now I say I'm doing the same thing that he was trying to do, but I'm just doing it with a culture that's even better than jazz. I'm doing it with hip-hop. And the difference between Corbusier and I, Corbusier was trying to learn about jazz, right? He really didn't know about it. He wasn't part of the culture. I was born and raised in the culture, right? I have a lot of friends who are rappers, hip-hop artists. So the difference is he was trying to learn about it, and I know about it, but I'm also in architecture, so it's just a big difference. And I joke and call him forefather of hip-hop. He had this plan that, again, I won't talk about plan too much, but he had a plan for Paris where he wanted to give poor people or working class people a better life. So he built all these towers. Well, he didn't build them, but he drew these towers and said, this is what I will do for working class people to make their life better. Basically, it was tearing up the entire, the century of Paris. Paris didn't do it. They thought it was crazy. They didn't have to build that. But guess who did? The United States. So if you look at his images for Paris in the 1910s, 1920s that he developed, boom, we did the same. We did the exact thing that he was envisioning for Paris right here in the United States. And we built these tall towers that he was thinking about, predominantly in black and brown communities. These became the projects, these the hood. This is an image from Detroit. But the same thing exists in Chicago, St. Louis, New York, all around the country, that building, that typology looked exactly the same. And the crazy thing about it, it's a crucifix, it's a cross. He thought that people's lives were so crazy that he could give them the ability to come and live in this building that's shaped like a cross and control pretty much everything about their life. He thought it would just make people better. Paris like, dude, you crazy. The United States? It's perfect. So as we went around destroying black communities all around the country, this is New York. It's an expressway called the Cross Bronx Expressway. Basically uprooted an entire, they called it slum clearance, urban renewal, all these kind of fancy words. They're trying to mask what they're doing. But they basically tore up a black community and replaced it with these towers. And it happened everywhere. In Detroit, I'm working with some group right now. We're talking about the same thing that happened in Detroit. And then the last thing about this dude, Prabhu, he wrote this book called The City of Tomorrow. It's all about his ideas for Paris and how architecture can make people better. And he had five things that he pointed out that were, well, he had a number of things that he pointed out, but I'm extracting five of them. He said that these things would make those communities work. Translucent prisms of glass, immediate access to employment, these big green lawns, shade under the trees, and clean air and no noise. Right, so these towers that you see were supposed to be glass. Of course, we built it, we made it brick. And these towers were supposed to be places where people worked, and the little houses on the outside was where people would live. They're called tenement houses. We totally remixed it and flipped it on its head. Instead of making the tall places where people work, we made the tall places where people lived. All right, and the whole idea of having a space next to you where you could work was just tossed out of the window. So they took his idea and just messed it up. And this is a perfect example of it. This guy named Robert Moses, I say he did the worst remix in history, where he took everything that they hated about that architecture, and he made sure that it happened. And he crossed out everything that should have worked. All right, so eventually this would become the birthplace of hip-hop. When they built the Cross Bronx Expressway, if y'all didn't know, hip-hop has a birthday and birthplace. The birthplace is 1520 Sedgwick Avenue, which is in the Bronx. This is a housing project with a guy named DJ Kool Herc and his sister threw a back-to-school party. I think the girls have to pay something like 25 cents, and guys have to pay like 50 cents. And they did this to raise money to buy their clothes for back-to-school. So there was inner projects. This project was built right on the Cross Bronx Expressway, well, near the Cross Bronx Expressway, and it was suggested to be built by this guy, Robert Moses. So I tie all this history that people knew about and say that all the horrible decisions that they made resulted in the birth of hip-hop. And then I say something fancy so I can get invited to places to come talk. So I say hip-hop is modernism's post-occupancy evaluations. What? Basically, I'm saying, when we talk about stuff in hip-hop, we're talking about the horrible environments that y'all made that we now have to live in. So drugs didn't come from us. They were brought into our communities. We didn't make the ghetto, right? Our actions, our culture is not the thing that created the ghetto. It actually was educated people who built and constructed purposely those spaces of squalor that we had to thrive in, basically. But that's what I said. And post-occupancy means when you build a space as an architect, interior designer, etc. Say we were building a hospital. We would go to the hospital after we build it, and we would ask people in the hospital, like, hey, you know, how are the emergency rooms working? How's your desk working out for you? How's the birthing suite working out for you? So we'll ask the doctors, the nurses, then we'll ask the janitors, the building engineers. We'll really find out how successful that project was so that the next time we do it, it'll work. That didn't happen with the projects, right? They just built the projects, threw us in it, all right, y'all make it. All right, they didn't come back to see how successful it was. Not on a large scale. We have people who did it here and there, but on a large scale, it didn't happen. So again, those little things that I pointed out from Prabhu, listen to this song, which is part of the, it's noted by Rolling Stone as the number one hip-hop, number one rap song of all time. So remember these things right here. And listen to how rap contradicts everything that this dude said that he was going to put in the community.
Broken glass everywhere. People pissing on the stairs. You know they just don't care. I can't take the smell. Can't take the noise. Got no money to move out. I guess I got no choice. Rats in the front room. Roaches in the back. Junkies in the alley with the baseball bat. I tried to get away, but I couldn't get far. Cause a man with the touch of repossessed my car. Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep going under.
Alright, so that's a song by Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. But listen, when he said I was going to give y'all translucent prisms of glass, the very first thing they said is broken glass everywhere. He said that they were going to give them tranquil, peaceful environments, like clean air, no noise. He comes and says, I can't take the smell, I can't take the noise. Then they talked about giving you immediate access to employment. He said, I tried to get away, but I couldn't get far because a man with a tow truck repossessed my car. Meaning they don't have money, they don't have the opportunities that were said would be given in those communities. And then it had another impact. He said, don't push me because I'm close to the edge, I'm trying not to lose my head. Basically saying that this environment is having an impact on the people who live in it. And Paris didn't do it. I won't read the whole quote, but I'll read the bottom. Paris didn't do it because they said that it was going to drive people crazy if they built these buildings. And that's exactly what it did with some of the inhabitants. But I won't say drive people crazy, let me not say that. I'll say it's going to have a negative impact on the people who live in these environments. But Paris basically said, poor creatures, what will they become? And said that if we put people in these houses, it'll make them long for this order. Right? So they were thinking about this way back in the day. The United States just totally ignored it. So then you got people like, this is a song called The Same Game by the West Coast All-Stars. So a song back in the 90s that took all the big hip-hop artists on the West Coast and they made one song together about stopping the violence that's happening around projects. We're just in the hood in general. But this dude, Digital Underground, he said, I'm in a rage because other races, they say we act like rats in a cage. So I've heard that before. It's in a lot of lines. I took some of the other songs out. But a lot of people have said this before. I'm in a rage because other races say we act like rats in a cage. What are they talking about? This is another person you should Google. I think you should talk about in schools. His name is John B. Calhoun. He did a whole lot of experiments with rats and mice. He put them in these tall towers, gave them control of resources, sounds just like welfare, and then he wanted to see what would happen with the rats. And basically rats, he said that they were no longer rats and mice. They started to do things that he's never seen rats and mice do, like chew on each other's tails. He also said that he called them juveniles. He was real strategic with his wording. He said the young juveniles would gang up and go and rape some of the males, or they would go and kill some of the males. He talked about some of the birth deficiencies some of the issues of reproducing that the female rats had. So he talked about all these conditions that will happen if we put people in overcrowded situations and control the resources that we give to them. And again, the U.S. didn't listen. He wrote a letter after he basically told HUD and the government that if we build projects the way that we're thinking about it, we're going to create people that act just like the rats that I've seen. And they took all this money away, they called him crazy, said you think rats are people, blah, blah, blah. He ended up writing a letter saying that the United States is interested in creating the issue with the rats and people and not interested in solving the situation before it happened. So when you say something like hood rat, it got a whole new meaning. It's not just a word. It actually comes from somewhere. So you call somebody a hood rat, it's one of the words that I hate, it's used a lot. Somebody actually was experimenting with people like you. That's why they call it the projects, right? It's a project. That's enough of that. All right, so I talk about a lot of stuff like that, get real deep, but here's more of the fun stuff. So I look at hip-hop elements to see how to turn those elements into architecture. Some of these things I might have to break, like browse through kind of quickly, because my 10-minute person just rose to the 10-minute sign. So, again, I got to make stuff sound fancy, so I call it structural stability of breaking. So basically looking at this idea that breakdancers, they can get into a certain pose and they can hold it when they battle against each other, right? So who can hold this freeze the longest, or get into these awkward situations, blah, blah, blah. Is it possible for us to study what I call the structural stability, right? The force that's exerted on their hands, their head, the torsion, the hips, those things that we study in architecture. And can we turn these into new items? So these were some sketches made by an artist named Florian Nicole. And then I took this idea and now I'm starting to create furniture that's in or that's based on the freezes of or moves of different breakdancers. Right? So can we start to create that furniture? Can the furniture be just as flexible as the breakdancers themselves? So can we take it one day as a chair, the next day it's a coffee table, right? So how can hip hop directly influence architecture? These are some chairs by Pharrell. Everybody know who Pharrell is. He created some chairs called the Perspective Chair. Pretty dope what he's doing with architecture and design. This is another idea. I say this hip-hop architecture is simply allowing hip-hop artists to create architecture. So this is a project that Pharrell is doing as well. It's called the Pharrell Williams Resource Center, where he's looking to bring all those resources that our country sometimes want to take away or underfund in certain communities, and he's bringing them back into the communities with the Pharrell Williams Resource Center, which is a project in his hometown. And then there's a project that I'm working on called the Universal Hip Hop Museum, which is like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but this is a museum for hip hop artists in the Bronx. And I did something called a design cipher, where I had hip-hop artists from all around the country. We went to the Bronx. I invited a lot of my friends who are designers and architects, and we worked for 3 days with hip-hop artists. This guy is Curtis Blow. And Curtis Blow, he was the first person to ever receive a record deal as a singer, as an individual rapper. Curtis Blow was there. They had a Sugar Hill Gang. They were there as well. So we weren't just working with any hip hop artists. We were working with some of the rappers who really defined what rap is. So this is Sugar Hill Gang. People are like, what's that? Like, they're singing this on everybody know hip hop, hip hop, they don't stop. Like that old school song, right? So we had them, and this is what eventually became of a series of meetings, different people being added to the team, and so this is what the project is. It's in the Bronx. In the background is something called Harlem River, but the museum is like the first two floors, and on top of it is public housing, right? Because we feel that public housing has been doing wrong for years, for decades, so if anybody's going to fix it, it should be hip-hop artists who can make public housing a lot better than a lot of these artists, you know, grew up in projects around New York. Then we said, hey, it costs a lot of money. Anybody here ever been to New York? So, only a few people. So it costs a lot of money to go to New York, so we also created this, and we're working on it now. It's the mobile museum. So it's basically a 16-wheeler that can go around to different communities and take the museum with it. Take the museum with it, so they can pull up to schools, festivals, etc., and show people what's in the museum. Then we called it Hip Hop in its Prime, because it's now transforms. And then all of this stuff that I've done, all these lectures at different places, I created this thing called the Hip Hop Architecture Camp, where I work with youth to teach them how to use architecture to make their communities better, but also how to do things like 3D modeling, 3D printing, and we make rap songs about our communities, etc. It's sponsored by a company named Autodesk. They make all the software that architects and engineers use. Like Ms. Wright was saying, Dean Wright, my work has been featured on ESPN. It's a magazine called Architect Magazine. That's the magazine of our profession. The Today Show, Lavity, Vader, Vibe. A lot of people have picked up the work because it is something I think is pretty dope and different. And we've done a camp all across the country, but I'll get to some of the fun parts we have. So basically what we do during the camp, I think the problem with rap is not really a problem with rap, it's a problem with people who try to listen to it. I think you have to be skilled to listen to rap music. You have to know how to listen to rap music. And a lot of people just don't know how to do that. So one of the first things I do is we print out some of the lyrics of your favorite songs, and we go through the lyrics, and we do something called a bar graph. Like every song in hip-hop is a bar, right? So people used to say the line and say something sweet, they like bars. Right? That's where it came from, because every line in hip-hop is a bar. Then we make these graphs about our music, right? So they turn that music into this bar graph. It's a pretty dope analysis that ends up looking like a city. Then we explore a lot of different tools, whether it's Legos, different building materials, and we try to create that bar graph, right? So now they're literally creating music that you can hold in your hand.
Can you?
And then we work with them to create 3D models of their city. So this is a young lady who used Chance the Rapper, No Problems, and she created a city based off of Chance the Rapper song.
Can you explain what you're doing? What you up to? You're finishing your city? What's it about? I'm sorry, what?
So it's about Chance the Rapper, and she made a whole city based on, you know, the line, "You don't want no problems with me." It's pretty dope. And then we invite people, we invite artists to come. We have a rap battle. So who heard of Super Peach before? Or watch a show that Jermaine Dupri has. So we did a camp in Atlanta, so we had Super Peach come out. Like, the kids were all hype about it. Some of the boys like, "Oh, she'll be my girlfriend before she leaves." And Super Peach walked in, and like, nobody said a single word. But she came and judged their rap competition. She signed autographs for them. It was pretty dope. She talked about what she would do if she was to build her own community. This is my homegirl, Tiffany, who runs the camps with me. Whoever watched Black Ink? All right, so had Caesar come out and talk about the tattoo shops that he's building around the country, right? And then the other guy, tall guy, his name is John Lyon. He's a DJ for the Ricky Smiley Morning Show, who went to school for architecture and construction management. So we brought them back to judge the camp. So we're trying to match hip-hop artists or people who are somehow involved with hip-hop and architecture to come and be a part of the camps. So these were like the winners from our freestyle battle that we had. Niyano Waka's mom, Mama Dev. So Mama Dev came out. And these are some of the rap battles that happened. So I'll show y'all a short clip. So we do this camp for a week, and we have kids write their own song. We got like, you give them like maybe 30 minutes to an hour to write a song in most cases. So this was a girl's song that won one of our freestyle battles in Los Angeles. I guess before I show it, all the kids are sitting in a circle around her. Nobody has heard anybody's song yet, and everybody's real competitive and talking stuff. So here it is.
Y'all should know I have a dream just like Dr. King. I think kids across the world would be on some better things, but instead they should be up the streets running from police. It's like Dr. Green, peace to art and community. But we all know before peace there has to be a plan. So first we should evaluate where the problem's at. Community, city, activity, drugs, property, prostitution, brutality, and therefore morality. I got a few ways on how we can make it better. First, we all can start by using architecture, building gardens, parks, recreation centers. These can keep kids from becoming gang members. Jobs, churches, and even bakeries can help the homeless and keep them off the street. We got to start to work from the bottom up. That's how we're going to change it up, clean it up.
So
here
all the kids like hollering in the background, they're like, oh, I don't even want to go after that. Like, she makes me warm. And then we give away Beats by Dre headphones to the people who win the rap battles. And I know I'm like out of time now. So I'm going to show a couple little clips and then I'm going to stop. This is one from Austin, Texas.
The streets of the city
filled
with drugs and gangs.
So we actually record a real video.
We got gentrification taking over the nation. No schools got us lost in searching for our education. Then I embrace it. Our brains got us locked in these chains. Having police that can actually think, so we can all be in unity. A community, every diversity, everyone go to university. Prevent the city's kids with new programs from the school. Keeping diversity is the number one rule. We gotta give back, we gotta make a change. Don't do anything, it's the same. Kids help the generation, gotta work together, take a step by.
So every city has their own sound. And down in Texas, they got like that chopped and screwed, like real slow, like Bun B and Pimp C, all of them. So Texas had like this real slow, smooth sound. And this is what we did in Detroit.
Soul's hard as metal. Keep it real in the DR. Soul's hard as metal.
Watch those little kids.
Street lights help keep people safe. People get killed in the streets every day. Hip hop kids, we can change this. We got a dream, we can achieve this.
What the future of the hood go?
So this little kid was talking about something like a couple people left, right? But y'all live in Wisconsin. Maybe y'all don't have or haven't experienced this issue. So kids growing up in Detroit actually had to live on streets in communities that did not have street lights because the city couldn't pick a deal. And he's noticing that people were getting killed just walking to the store because you just can't see. So actually during the camp, he wanted to design street lights that were solar powered to help the city put street lights in communities like his so people are not facing some of those issues. And then the last thing here is we looked at tracks by artists, and I'll show you how we turn it into our cities. So here's a song by Joey Badass.
Tricked them in the system, but my niggas in prison. All our history hidden, ain't no liberty given. We all fit the description of what the document's written. We been lacking the vision and barely making a living. We too worried to fit in, while they been benefiting. Every time you submit it, we all guilty admitted. The law won't get you acquitted, but you still ask for forgiveness. But opiates and syringes, then inject this religion. Now many times I gotta tell you I'm a man in the mission. Many times I gotta tell you I don't need no permission. A human with supervision, ain't no living condition. I'm reaching out to my children.
Before, but we look at like rhyme schemes, cinnamon, the number of syllables that people use, double entendres, all these things that we can discover with lyrics. I'm working with Lupe Fiasco right now to create some more waves. But we look at this, and then we actually start to create cities and communities that are based on rhyme schemes and patterns that the artists create. So the doper the song that you can write or verse that you can write, we assume, hypothesize that maybe your city would be just as good. So look at pop.
With all my sex and stress, the question I wonder is after death, I tell my last breath. When will I finally get to listen to this oppression? They punish the people that's asking questions and those that possess. Give from the ones without possession.
bringing the riches in the position of making a difference. Politicians and hypocrites, they don't want to listen. And from these things, the blame ain't about to change. It wasn't nothing like the game, it's just me against the world.
I said, look at Pop, Me Against the World. Like, can we start to make our cities better? Like, there was this old wax song that says, we built the city on rock and roll. Like, we built the city on rock and roll. Like, can we use hip hop and rap to start building cities? So these are a number of different songs. Or ideas for communities that people have based on rap, and then we also create our own pieces of work. Like there's a song by JC called Picasso Baby, and I think if everybody in this room was to use their culture and tap into their culture to create art, to create communities, we can create something that's better than what Picasso ever dreamed of, right? Because he was still in black culture. We live and we breathe black culture. So these are pieces of artwork that I have students create that analyzes the lyrics that they create, or lyrics that are famous rappers. So this is I Go to Work, old track by Kumo D, and this is a song by Eric B and Rakim called Follow the Leader. And all this work ended up getting me with Madison Public Library, we were called the Top Innovators of 2017 for programming around race and social equity.
Everyone else, I'm dismissed by rows. So after the teachers go, I would like the back rows to